Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this very special Emanu-El Reads event. I want first to thank our extraordinary Stettenheim librarian, Liza Stabler, for her efforts making the evening possible, as well as so much of the learning that goes on within these walls. So please join me in thanking Liza. Inspired by congregant Max Moss's idea for a congregation-wide reading experience, Emanu-El Reads is a journey of learning undertaken each year by our temple community. The first selection years ago was a biography of Maimonides, the medieval giant of Jewish law and philosophy. Next, the congregation tackled Abraham Joshua Heschel's spiritual discussion of the Sabbath. Other selections were Nicole Krauss's masterful contemporary American novel, The History of Love, journalist David Plotz's good book about his experience of reading the Hebrew Bible from cover to cover, celebrated Israeli novelist Aleph Bet Yehoshua's The Liberated Bride, and The Eichmann Trial by noted historian and scholar Deborah Lipstadt. And of course, last year, Emanu-El read and discussed When General Grant Expelled the Jews by Jonathan Sarna, which is a riveting account of Ulysses Grant's decision in the middle of the Civil War to order the expulsion of all Jews from the territory under his command. Our selection for this program year is FDR and the Jews, a New York Times Book Review Editor's Choice by Richard Breitman and Allan Lichtman. In their work, Professors Lichtman and Breitman have examined more primary sources than any previous historians in their effort to discover whether President Franklin Delano Roosevelt did all he could to help the Jews of Nazi Europe. In the coming days, there will be opportunities for us to discuss the book in smaller groups, tomorrow with the Men's Club Reading Group, on Sunday with religious school parents, on Monday morning with the Women's Auxiliary, and next Wednesday night with the Stettenheim Literary Circle. The times are on the temple website. Tonight, though, a very special treat. We're deeply honored to have Allan Lichtman with us. Allan J. Lichtman is Distinguished Professor of History at American University in Washington. He has authored or co-authored 8 books, including White Protestant Nation, The Rise of the American Conservative Movement, which was a finalist for the National Book Critics Circle Award in Nonfiction. And he wrote The Keys to the White House. The Keys system correctly predicted the popular vote outcome in every presidential election from 1984 to 2012. Dr. Lichtman has been honored as the American University Scholar and Teacher of the Year, the university's highest academic honor. He has lectured extensively in the United States and abroad, and has provided commentary for all major television and radio networks, regularly being quoted by leading newspapers and magazines worldwide. He has published more than 200 scholarly and popular articles, and served as an expert witness in more than 80 federal voting rights and redistricting cases. As an expert for the United States Commission on Civil Rights, Dr. Lichtman determined that the outcome of the 2000 presidential election turned on the vast disparity in rates at which officials rejected ballots casted by blacks and whites in Florida. Tonight, his topic is FDR and the Jews. So please join me in welcoming Professor Allan J. Lichtman.
Thank you very much. I am not going to predict the outcome of the 2016 election. You're going to have to bring me back for that one. I'm going to talk for a little while, maybe about 45 minutes, and then I'll take any and all questions. Couple of ground rules. Please don't make speeches, and don't ask me anything about the opera, and we'll get along just fine. And of course, being a professor, I may have a few pop quizzes for all of you. And the temple assures me they have very big prizes for any of you who get these quizzes correct. I'm going to talk this evening about my new book, co-authored with Richard Breitman, FDR and the Jews, which I'm proud to say just won the National Jewish Book Award in American Jewish Studies, and we're very proud of that. and it'll bring me back to New York in March for the ceremony. Now, I would love to tell this distinguished audience that 6 or 7 years ago, I had this brilliant idea to write a new book about how FDR responded to Jewish concerns. But if I were to tell you that, to quote the late and not so great Richard Nixon, that would be wrong. It was entirely the idea of my co-author, Richard Breitman, to write this book. Professor Breitman is perhaps the world's leading authority on the Holocaust. He is the editor of the Journal of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. And about 6 or 7 years ago, he came to me and said, I want to write a book on FDR and the Jews. And he said, look, I know the European side, I know the Holocaust side, but I really don't know the American political and presidential side. But you're a political and presidential historian, and together I think we could write a great book. And of course, being a very foresightful scholar, my immediate response was, absolutely not. Why would I want to write a book on a topic about which there is already so much written? Surely the topic has been covered. But then I began to look at the literature, and I discovered something rather strange. I work in Washington, D.C. at American University. And you think, of course, there is tremendous polarization between the parties in Washington, D.C. Well, that polarization is nothing compared to the polarization in interpretations of FDR and the Jews. You truly had the Alpha and the Omega. On the one hand, you had books like The Abandonment of the Jews, The Jews Were Expendable, which argued that FDR was a bystander, or worse, to the persecution and ultimately the slaughter of the Jews by the Nazis and their collaborators across Europe. On the other hand, you had books like The Myth of Rescue or Saving the Jews, which argued that FDR was the great savior of the Jews, that he did everything possible to save and rescue the Jews. Well, I was not yet an expert on the topic, but being an experienced historian, I knew one thing. Neither one of those points of view could possibly be right. History is never that simple. It's never that black or white. And so indeed, I agreed with Professor Breitman to write this book. And we have sought to present a much more nuanced and balanced account of the topic than anyone had presented before. We weren't just going to kind of cut up the middle and go in between the two extremes. Our object was to write an entirely different kind of book, a book focused on how a humanitarian, but ultimately pragmatic president weaved his way through competing and conflicting priorities, including the persecution and slaughter of the Jews, at a time of the worst depression in the history of the world, the foreign policy crises of the late 1930s, and, of course, the bloodiest war in the history of the world, World War II. Franklin Roosevelt is the only American president to have led the nation through both a horrific depression and a terrible war. Franklin Roosevelt was also unique in another regard. Before FDR, how many presidents had served more than 2 terms? That's an easy one, right? None. Zero. Every president had always honored the George Washington tradition of serving only 2 terms in office. I've said FDR was a pragmatic politician, and you have to be a pragmatic politician to do what FDR did, not only to get elected 3 times president of the United States, but elected 4 times president of the United States. This so upset the opposition that a few years after the death of FDR, they passed a constitutional amendment, the current amendment forbidding any president from serving more than 2 terms. Now, our object was to write a very different kind of book. And to do that, we had to do three very distinctive things. Number one, most, if not all, of the important books begin with FDR's presidency, which starts, of course, in March of 1933. In those days, the inauguration was March 4th. It wasn't until FDR's second term that the lame duck amendment changed it to January 20th. And who almost simultaneously rose to power at the very time FDR was inaugurated president? Adolf Hitler in Germany. The two careers are almost exactly parallel, the Democrat and the dictator. Came to power at virtually the same time and died within a month or so of one another. We decided we were not going to start with FDR's presidency, but look at his entire life and his entire political career. Where is FDR from? New York, Hyde Park, New York. Where did half the Jews live in the 1930s in the United States? In New York. FDR had been involved with Jewish politics as a political leader in New York for 20 years before he became president of the United States. As you know as well, he grew up in a very wealthy, patrician, white, Protestant family. I want to say a little something about that. Do you know which Roosevelt, just before her death, traveled to Canada to give a talk to a Hadassah meeting? You probably think it's Eleanor Roosevelt, right? Wrong. It was the Grand Dame Sarah Delano Roosevelt, Franklin Roosevelt's mother, who was the primary shaping influence on his early life. He was an only child. His father was elderly, died when FDR was fairly young. His mother was the great shaping influence, and she was not anti-Semitic, although, you know, most people of that class in the late 19th and early 20th century were. She was deeply involved in charitable efforts, including charitable efforts for the Jews. And we discovered not only this trip when she was 84 years old to Canada, not an easy journey to speak to Hadassah, but she was also the recipient of the Einstein Medal for lifetime charitable contributions and service to the Jews. Not something you would expect from the kind of family that FDR grew up in. So very early on, he was inculcated in a degree of tolerance, and he was also inculcated with the idea that he was going to make his mark upon the world. He wasn't just going to live comfortably as a country squire in Hyde Park, New York, but he was destined for great things. An ideal that was deepened and strengthened when, at the age of 40, FDR was struck with polio. They used to call it infantile paralysis in those days because it was mainly an affliction with children. And FDR's struggle with polio deepened his commitment to the less advantaged and deepened his commitment not just to recover from polio, but to make his mark on the world. FDR famously said, "You know, nothing in the presidency seems all that hard after you've spent 6 months just learning to move your big toe." Now, not only was FDR involved in Jewish politics for 20 years before he became president, but when he recovered from polio, his comeback was in 1928 when he won election very narrowly as the governor of New York. Does anybody know who he defeated in 1928 to be elected governor? Who? Very good. Please get that woman a prize. Albert Ottinger, a Jewish Republican, the only Jewish candidate to that point for the governor of New York. And this was a campaign rife with charges of anti-Semitism on both sides. In fact, FDR had a Jewish running mate. He was running against a Jewish opponent, and he had a Jewish running mate for lieutenant governor. Anyone know who that was? Very famous name, Herbert Lehman of Lehman Brothers, later became governor of New York. And there was all of these charges and countercharges about who was a better Jew, Herbert Lehman or Albert Ottinger. Who knows what it means to be a better Jew, but this was a big debate in the gubernatorial election of 1928. And FDR learned a great deal about Jewish politics in that election. He learned, first of all, that while there are many Jewish leaders, they did not themselves sway the Jewish vote. You may have heard the old proverb, where there are two Jews, there are three opinions. The Jewish leaders did not have control of the Jewish vote, even though often they claimed they did. In addition, he learned that Jews do not necessarily vote according to religious issues or Jewish issues. In fact, a majority of Jews voted for him rather than for the Jewish Republican Albert Ottinger because they were more favorable to his liberal politics than the more conservative politics of his opponent. He also learned, and we found an unpublished document from FDR, it's very rare to find that, on religion and politics, in which FDR decried any kind of sectarian or religious injection into politics. He said in this document, absolutely, your philosophy and your ideals can and should be informed by your religion, but there is no place in American politics for the insertion of religion and sectarian issues in American elections. This is all indispensable background, which we discovered for understanding what FDR did as president. Second thing that we were going to do, and the rabbi alluded to this, we were going to build our book on original primary sources. Not so easy with FDR. FDR left no memoirs. He left precious few personal letters. How many transcriptions of FDR cabinet meetings survive? Another trick question. Zero. He never allowed his cabinet meetings to be recorded. He never allowed his cabinet meetings to be transcribed because he wanted his aides to be able to speak freely and openly. None of the meetings that FDR held with Jewish leaders or anyone else were transcribed either. So you had to search through a lot of different manuscripts and a lot of different reconstructions of meetings with FDR to find out what was really going on. And this took us to manuscript collections all over the world, all over the country, not just in Washington, D.C., the National Archives and the Library of Congress, but the Herbert Hoover Library in Iowa, the Hoover Institution out in California, libraries in Michigan, Connecticut, the New York Public Library here. And so we built our book on original sources, many of which had never been discovered before. Now, the third thing, and this is the hardest. It may seem really easy, but this is one of the hardest things you have to do as an historian, or for that matter, as a political forecaster, something I do in another aspect of my life. And that is, we strove not to write history backwards from what we know today, but rather to reconstruct the contemporary meaning and understanding of events. It's very easy to write history backwards in light of contemporary knowledge and to say, FDR should have done this and should have done that. And of course, everything would have turned out perfectly if only FDR had listened to me, what I had to say 70 years later. Of course, one can never prove or disprove anything in that kind of history. It is absolutely and utterly meaningless. This is a really hard thing to do because we know what happened. To reconstruct the decision-making and processes of the actors at the time operating under extreme uncertainty. They didn't know what the results of their actions would be, operating under extreme pressure and operating under the influence of many, many different important competing priorities. 100 things every day, as you know, land on the desk of an American president. And we came up with some major discoveries. One of our most important discoveries was that there was no single monolithic FDR response during his presidency to Jewish issues. FDR, remember, was a pragmatic, resourceful politician, and his policies changed, evolved, and adapted over time. We discovered four distinct Roosevelts during his presidency with respect to Jewish issues. At times in his presidency, he was very activist in trying to help persecuted Jews and trying to deal with the issues and the tragedy of the Holocaust. At times, he truly was a bystander who did not take strong action to deal with these issues. So, the first Roosevelt of the four is the Roosevelt of his first term. And the Roosevelt of his first term truly could be characterized as a bystander to the persecution of Jews. Remember, the Holocaust is still many years in the future. But FDR does not denounce Nazi Germany or the persecution of Jews. He does not mobilize diplomatic pressure on Nazi Germany. He does not support demonstrations and rallies within the United States. And most importantly, he does not open the gates of the United States to Jewish refugees. American immigration policy was set by the Johnson-Reed Act, signed by Calvin Coolidge in 1924. And that policy can be described in one word. Anybody know what that word is? Quotas. Every single nation of Europe had a quota. And what nations had the smallest quotas? Not Germany, but Eastern and Southern Europe. They were trying to close down immigration to Jews and Catholics. So Russia, Lithuania, Poland had tiny quotas, and Western and Northern countries had large quotas. The quota for Germany was pretty generous, over 25,000 per year. The countries I mentioned in Eastern Europe combined had less than 10,000 per year in their quotas. But in 1930, then President Herbert Hoover did something extraordinary. You know, we've talked, if you follow the news, there's been a lot of talk about the use of executive orders, right? And how much a president can do without going through Congress. Well, by executive decree in 1930, Herbert Hoover reinterpreted a clause of the immigration law which says you were not supposed to let in people likely to become public charges in the United States. And that had always meant you don't let people in who are physically or mentally incapable of work. Hoover reinterpreted that to mean you don't let in anyone who didn't have enough wealth to support themselves in the United States. This unilaterally slashed immigration by 90%. 90%. In 1932, for the first time, more people were leaving the United States than coming into the United States. Why did Herbert Hoover do this in 1930? The Great Depression. And they were under what I think is a very misguided notion, which still guides some of the debates over immigration, that immigration is a zero-sum game, that every immigrant from abroad takes a job away from an American. Most economists don't believe that at all. They understand immigration has a multiplier effect. A lot of immigrants take jobs that Americans living in the U.S. don't take. They start businesses. They invest. They buy things. It has a multiplier positive effect on the economy. But that was not the thinking of Hoover, and Roosevelt does not change that interpretation of immigration law in his first term, even though he could have done so with a stroke of a pen. So why? Why this lack of a response to the persecuted Jews of Germany? Start with this. What was FDR's response to the persecuted African Americans in the South, right here in the United States? Nothing. He had no civil rights program whatsoever. In fact, he had a deal with Southern Democrats. I'll let you keep your Jim Crow race policies, and you support the New Deal. And that deal was in place throughout most of his presidency. You know, in those days, the South was solidly Democratic. In four elections, FDR won every single Southern state, never lost a Southern state. Won most of them by 60% or more. Another reason why FDR does not do anything for minorities in the U.S. or Jews abroad is his higher priorities. What's FDR's number one priority when he takes office in 1933? Fighting the Great Depression. He knows if the economy doesn't improve, he's going to be a failed one-term president, another Hoover. Second big priority is his New Deal program, the most ambitious program of liberal reform in the history of the country. He does not want his programs to look like minority programs. He does not want to rub raw ethnic antagonisms at a time of tremendous prejudice based on race and a tremendous amount of anti-Semitism in the country. Anti-Semitism was not as virulent as it was in much of Europe, but it was there, and it was pretty widespread among the non-Jewish populations in the United States. The other thing he's trying to do is build the Democratic Party. And what is the most important organized constituency that he's building his Democratic Party upon? Same thing that Democrats rely on today, although it's greatly diminished, organized labor, right? And what was the position of organized labor in the 1930s on immigration? They didn't want any immigrants coming into the United States because they subscribed to the idea that they would be taking jobs away from their own members. So put all of this together and you have a president who does little or nothing as persecutions of Jews mount during his first term. Then FDR is reelected in 1936, defeats Alf Landon, the governor of Kansas, and wins by a landslide. His campaign manager, Jim Farley, predicted before the election that FDR would win every state except Maine and Vermont. And that's exactly what happened. He won 46 other states. It used to be an old saying, because Maine votes early, as goes Maine, so goes the nation. After the 1936 election, that saying was changed to as goes Maine, so goes Vermont. Now you got to remember, at this time, FDR is not thinking about a third term. That would come much later after the war in Europe breaks out. So he is kind of free politically now. And you get the second Roosevelt, the Roosevelt of most of the second term, that becomes very activist with respect to the plight of the Jews in Germany. First of all, he finally ends the Hoover restrictions on immigration. For the first time, the quota for Germany is filled during FDR's second term. Secondly, he lets 10 to 15,000 Jews who are in the United States on visitors' visas stay permanently. They don't have to go back to Germany. So you're talking about many tens of thousands of Jews being helped by these new immigration policies. In addition, in 1938, he comes up on his own, not from a State Department. State Department during this period is an absolute obstacle and barrier to doing anything for the Jews. Number one, it's filled with a lot of old line patricians who are themselves anti-Semitic. And number two, just like today, what's their main priority in the Middle East where Palestine is located? Oil. Exactly, the huge amounts of oil that the Arab peoples are sitting upon. So this has nothing to do with the State Department. It's his own initiative to organize an international conference to try to resettle the Jews around the world, particularly in Latin American countries. This is the Evian Conference, held in Evian, France, in the summer of 1938. And the conference is a big failure, not because of FDR, but because the nations of the world are not willing to open their doors to Jewish refugees. The Washington Post at the time, in an excellent article, called the Evian Conference the Yes But Conference. Yes, we sympathize with the plight of these poor peoples, but not here. As nation after nation got up and made those kinds of comments. There was only one nation that made a major commitment to the Jews. Anybody know what that was? The Dominican Republic, right? Under the horrible dictator Rafael Trujillo. And it was never real. he was just doing this to try to rehabilitate his reputation. And they did establish a refuge for Jews in the Dominican, but less than 1,000 Jews ever made it there. So the Evian Conference turns out to be a big failure, but FDR was the only world leader trying to promote places for the resettlement of the Jews. Now, also during this period, you have a very famous episode. It involves a ship. Anybody know what that ship was? The St. Louis. How many of you have seen the movie The Voyage of the Damned? Yeah, quite a few, and all of you know about it. And, you know, from The Voyage of the Damned and other popular culture accounts, there is a kind of conventional wisdom about the voyage of the St. Louis. St. Louis set sail from Hamburg in May of 1939 with 937 Jewish passengers aboard. They were going to Cuba. Well, Cuba turned down almost all the passengers. They tried to get in the United States. FDR wouldn't let them in. They went back to Germany and ultimately perished in the death camps. There is a small grain of truth to that, but as we discovered, only a small grain. We have found the documents to completely reinterpret the St. Louis tragedy. Number one, why were Jews going from Hamburg to, of all places, Cuba? Because FDR had ordered his one guy that he could rely upon in the State Department, Under Secretary of State Sumner Wells, to pressure every single Latin American country to take in Jewish refugees, at least temporarily, while they waited for visas to get into the United States. The dictator of Cuba, same guy who Castro tossed out in 1959, anyone know who that was? Batista meets with Roosevelt. Of course, we have no transcript, but a week later, Batista says, "I am happy to cooperate with your great President Roosevelt in helping to find places for these unfortunate people." Before the passengers on the St. Louis reached Havana Harbor, 5,000 to 6,000 Jews had already settled in Cuba. That never would have happened without the efforts of FDR and Sumner Wells. Moreover, there was a big issue in letting them into the United States. To get into the United States, you have to have a visa. And the visa had an 11-year waiting list. There were over 300,000 persons waiting for visas. So to let the St. Louis passengers in, you'd have had to break the quota and jump over everyone else on the waiting list. Now, this is now June of 1939. What does the United States know is coming? They don't know when it's coming, but they know pretty soon something horrific is coming, right? War. Everyone believes war is coming soon. Now, FDR's number one priority in the event of war is to loosen the neutrality acts that Congress had passed over several previous years and that tied his hands, would have prevented him from aiding any of the nations resisting Nazi aggression in the event of war. He knows if he picks a big fight with Congress, which is isolationist and restrictionist, over letting the St. Louis passengers in, his chances of getting the Neutrality Acts changed were very, very small. As it was, he had to fight like crazy to get the Neutrality Acts modified after the outbreak of war. He barely got it through, and then ultimately had to fight for his big program of aid to the nations resisting Nazi aggression, the Lend-Lease program that sent billions of dollars to Great Britain and the Soviet Union. Well, imagine if he had let the St. Louis passengers in, had a huge fight with Congress, and was unable to get the Neutrality Acts revised. And you wouldn't have had Lend-Lease. Then there's an excellent chance that Germany would have conquered the Soviet Union and killed 3 to 4 million more Jews. And of course, FDR would have been judged much more harshly by history. Finally, how many of the St. Louis passengers actually went back to Germany? Zero. Places were found for them primarily through the efforts of the major Jewish aid organizations supported by the Roosevelt administration, the Jewish Joint Distribution Committee, and they were all resettled in Belgium, Holland, France, and England. This was 1939. There was no war. Everybody thought these were safe places. In fact, the passengers themselves wrote to the head of the Distribution Committee, "We are as grateful as this wide ocean on which we are sailing. Nobody knew in June of 1939 that a year later, the Nazis would overrun France, Belgium, and the Netherlands, and then after that begin the Holocaust against the Jews. At the time, everyone believed they were safe. So while the Saint, and ultimately two-thirds of them survived. About a third of them were killed in the Holocaust, but the survival rate was two-thirds, which is much higher than most of the Jews in places under Nazi occupation and influence. So the real story is quite different. Then, after the outbreak of war, you get a third Roosevelt, whose activism on behalf of Jews is greatly diminished. Why? Roosevelt understands not only does he have to aid the Allies, and that's going to be difficult enough to get that through a restrictionist and isolationist Congress, even though it's a Democratic Congress. Lots of Democrats are isolationists and anti-immigrant. And he knew ultimately the United States was going to get into the war one way or the other. And the last thing he wanted was to be perceived as fighting a war for the Jews. At a time of widespread anti-Semitism, he believed, rightly or wrongly, that he had to unite the nation around common themes. This is one of the big lessons of our book, a lesson about anti-Semitism, that it is often the perception and fear of anti-Semitism that is worse than the reality of anti-Semitism. Hard to comprehend, but true. This perception and fear of anti-Semitism paralyzes good people and prevents them from taking often necessary humanitarian actions. The other thing that FDR was worried about was if you let a lot of Jews from Germany coming into the United States after the outbreak of war, that the Nazis would place spies, saboteurs, and agents among them. He now knew he was going to run for re-election in 1940. He was going to go for a third term. And he knew if his immigration policy let in agents and saboteurs and spies and there was a terrible incident in the United States, he'd probably lose in 1940, and the isolationist and restrictionist Republicans would win, and there'd be no chance we'd aid the Allies and very little chance we'd ever get involved in the war. And this kind of non-activist Roosevelt persists through several years of the war. But there is one very important exception, one thing that Roosevelt did. Where was the war fought first? North Africa, right? Remember Rommel, the Desert Fox. And what's the big prize that Rommel was trying to capture as part of the British Empire? Egypt, exactly, the Suez Canal and Egypt. If he takes Egypt, what else does he take? Palestine. And the Nazis had a killing squad waiting for Rommel to conquer Egypt and take Palestine, and they were prepared to kill every single Jew in Palestine. And of course, the big decisive battle was the Second Battle of El Alamein, fought mainly by the British, which prevented Rommel from taking Egypt and Palestine. That battle may not have been won except for what FDR did. He took personal initiative to cut through the wartime bureaucracy and send 300 Sherman tanks to the British forces. And he had to send them twice because the first shipment was sunk by German U-boats. And I'm not a military historian, but many military historians believe that those 300 Sherman tanks were essential for the Allied victory at El Alamein that kept Rommel from taking Egypt and kept the Nazis from killing all the Jews of Palestine, and of course made possible the creation of the modern state of Israel. Then finally, later in the war, you get the fourth Roosevelt, who takes a more activist position. In January 1944, under pressure from the Congress and influenced mainly by his Jewish Secretary of the Treasury. Who is that? Morgan, Henry Morgenthau Jr., who by this time has become his most important advisor. FDR sets up, by executive order, again, the power of the executive order, because he never would have got it through Congress, a war Refugee Board, the only body of its kind anywhere in the world dedicated to trying to rescue the surviving Jews of Europe, particularly in Hungary, which was under Nazi influence but did not have a very large number of Nazi troops. The War Refugee Board, although underfunded, because he had to fund it out of his own contingency fund, probably succeeded, and numbers on the Holocaust are not entirely accurate, but they could be credited with saving as many as 200,000 Jews. Obviously, only a small portion of the 6 million Jews that were slaughtered by the Nazis. During this period of the Fourth Roosevelt, there's another big controversy that arises. What was the main death camp of the Nazis? Auschwitz. And in the summer of 1944, for the first time, because of a base in Foggia, Italy, American bombers were capable of reaching the death camp and coming back. And proposals reached the War Refugee Board to bomb the crematoria and gas chambers at Auschwitz, or to bomb at least the rail lines leading to Auschwitz. Now, what you got to understand about the War Refugee Board, they had absolutely no authority whatsoever to mobilize any military resources. That was actually written in to the executive order. It's the only way the War Department would have agreed to it. So they had to go to the War Department to get authorization to do this. And the head of the War Refugee Board, John Pelley, doesn't recommend the bombing, but he does pass it on to the bureaucracy of the War Department. And it goes to the official in charge, a guy by the name of John J. McCloy, kind of a famous American. There's a whole biography written about him that won the Pulitzer Prize called The Chairman. He had all kinds of powerful positions. He was a super lawyer. He was head of the Rockefeller Foundation. Within a day or two, he summarily rejects the idea of the bombing. And utilizing what would become the standard line of the War Department, that we cannot divert military resources for humanitarian purposes. The war is far from won, it's at a critical point, and we need to use all military resources for military purposes. And the best way to save the surviving Jews is to win the war as quickly as possible. Now, this issue of the bombing of Auschwitz, remarkably, was a non-issue at the time. It became an issue 20 to 25 years after the fact, when books critical of FDR's response to Jewish issues began to emerge. At the time, not a single major Jewish leader in the United States, not a single major Jewish newspaper were advocating the bombing of Auschwitz. The bombing of the rail lines was never realistic because we had bombed other rail lines, and within days and even hours, the Germans were able to repair it. But the bombing of Auschwitz was never being advocated by Jewish leaders, the Jewish press. There were two huge rescue rallies, one in New York and one in Los Angeles, neither one of which mentioned the bombing of Auschwitz. Why weren't Jewish leaders advocating the bombing of Auschwitz? Any of you been to Auschwitz? If you have, you see 40,000 Jews were living in wooden barracks. What would have happened if we bombed Auschwitz? And by the way, the idea of precision pinpoint bombing was nonsense back then and is even nonsense today. Even the war in Kosovo, we hit the Chinese embassy and, you're always missing your targets. Most of those Jews would have perished in a major bombing raid on Auschwitz. And the Jewish leaders did not want Jewish blood on Allied hands. And it was very dubious whether they could have put the gas chambers and crematoria out of commission at any rate. In addition, this is one of the sad stories of the Holocaust, the Nazis were absolutely resourceful when it came to the killing of Jews. They killed hundreds of thousands of Jews before they set up a single death camp, and they killed hundreds of thousands of Jews when the last death camp at Auschwitz was shut down at the end of 1944. Even if you could have put out the gas chambers and crematoria at Auschwitz, you would have made the killing less efficient, but you would not have stopped the mass murder, the Holocaust, against the Jews. And this is another extraordinary thing about people's understanding at the time, not, you know, many years later. People at the time, including influential and brilliant Jews like Felix Frankfurter, FDR's advisor, who FDR put on the Supreme Court. By the way, FDR had more Jewish advisors than any previous president and appointed more Jews to federal positions than all previous American presidents combined. 15% of his first term appointments were Jewish. So even people like Felix Frankfurter had a lot of difficulty wrapping their minds around the Holocaust. Even after reliable information about the Holocaust began to come into the United States starting in late 1942, the famous Rigner telegram informing the world about the Nazis weren't just killing Jews, they were engaged in this systematic effort to slaughter Jews wherever they could be found across all national borders, men, women, and children. Why couldn't people wrap their minds around this? Because they could not understand why, in the midst of this war to the death, would the Nazis devote so much resources and so much manpower to the killing of Jews? Why not turn the Jews into slave labor? Why murder them? Why slaughter them? Why annihilate them? In Auschwitz alone, 8,000 to 10,000 German troops were being tied down. They could have been used in the Battle of the Bulge or other battles of the war. What was so hard for people to understand, and is even hard today, is for the Nazis, the killing of Jews was not a diversion from the war. It was a major aim of the war. There have, of course, been many genocides before and since. You know, before the Holocaust against the Jews, there was the genocide against the Armenians that resulted in the death of perhaps 1 million Armenians in the Ottoman Empire. And of course, since then, there have been genocides in places like Cambodia, Rwanda, and Darfur. But there is something that makes the Holocaust a very special horror. Before or since, it is the only time that a major modern industrial state devoted all of its resources and all of its might to wiping out the biological substance of an entire people wherever they might be found. Had they conquered Russia, they would have killed the Jews in Russia. Had they conquered the US, they would have killed the Jews in the US. Had they taken Palestine, they would have killed the Jews in Palestine. This is still stands out as a singular evil and a singular tragedy, even in an age of genocide, and some historians have called the 20th century the age of genocide. A few final thoughts. First of all, what is our ultimate assessment of FDR and the Jews? Again, not necessarily based on what we know, but based on information at the time. FDR was far from perfect when it came to aiding Jews and responding to their concerns. He often put other priorities on a higher level, but he was vastly better than his isolationist and restrictionist political opposition at home that was also shot through with degrees of anti-Semitism. And he was better than any other world leader, including the great Winston Churchill, who always talked a big game about the Jews, but did little or nothing. And during the war, it was his government that greatly restricted the ability of Jews to reach Palestine, which was, of course, then under the control of the British. I want to finally talk a little bit about the difficulty of making humanitarian decisions as a president under extreme pressure. Let's bring it to the present day. A few years ago, one of Barack Obama's chief advisors was a woman named Samantha Power, who wrote the big book on genocide and was highly critical of American presidents' response. And she was very influential in influencing President Obama, at least partly on humanitarian grounds, to intervene in Libya. So he does what most other presidents don't do. He organizes, at least in part, a humanitarian intervention. What's the response? He's criticized from the right, and he's criticized from the left. He's blasted on the one hand by Newt Gingrich. He's blasted on the other hand by Dennis Kucinich. Flash forward a couple of years, a humanitarian crisis in Syria, and FDR makes the opposite decision. He decides not to go into Syria. And what is the response? He's criticized from the right, and he is criticized from the left. And this shows, you know, when you're not dealing in long retrospect, but you're dealing with the contemporary immediate reality, just how difficult these decisions are about what is the responsibility of an American president to humanitarian crises involving foreign peoples. Final thought, and it's a sad one. The tragedy of the Holocaust is a tragedy of all humanity. You can point your fingers at any given leader, at what they did and didn't do, but collectively, the evil people of the world were much more dedicated to wreaking tragedy upon the Jews than the good people of the world were dedicated to doing something about it. And the Holocaust survivors, and you know, we're coming to the point where, except for small children, the Holocaust survivors are about to pass from this earth. You know, their testimony is so important in keeping alive our understanding and our emotional understanding of this singular tragedy in human history. And they also stand as a reminder that people can survive the worst evil. People can thrive. In 1943, a group of expatriates from Palestine who became activists in the rescue efforts in the United States organized a pageant called We Will Never Die. And the Holocaust survivors are living reminders of the truth of those words for the Jewish people. Thank you so much. I'm happy to take all your questions. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, sir. It may be correct.
Was a major obstacle to the letting in of Jews and impeded the World Refugee Board as much as possible. And yet, nothing was done about that.
Correct. Now, you're basically correct. And I would even go a step farther. This is the third Roosevelt who wants to restrict for the reasons I explained to you after the outbreak of the war. Jewish immigration, any kind of immigration for that matter, into the United States. Breckinridge Long was not a career State Department person. He was a political leader. He had run for the Senate and had been the campaign manager for Franklin Roosevelt's convention victory in 32. And basically, he was anti-Semitic, he was underhanded, and he was absolutely dedicated to keeping out immigrants, particularly Jews, but generally any kind of immigrants during the war. But he was FDR's hatchet man. FDR knew what he was doing when he put Breckinridge Long in, because that was FDR's policy, to cut back, for the reasons I've explained, in immigration to the United States. And the State Department, though, it wasn't just Breckinridge Long. It was the whole State Department, for the most part, that was obstructionist. One of the reasons FDR sets up the War Refugee Board is that Henry Morgenthau Jr. had this group of young activists members of his Treasury Department, most of them not Jewish, and they discovered that, in fact, the State Department not only had been obstructing rescue efforts, but had actually been blocking information coming in from Europe about the Holocaust. And one of Morgenthau's aides, Josiah Du Bois, wrote a memo, it's basically entitled, America's Complicity in the Slaughter of the Jews. And it was that discovery and that memo, which never reached FDR, Morgenthau decided it was much too incendiary, that prompted Morgenthau to go to FDR and get the War Refugee Board set up. And Morgenthau, you know, was very conflicted. You know, as he talked to these young Turks in his department, he'd always say, look, I am the secretary of all the people, and I am a Jew, but I've got to be very, very careful that I'm not perceived as a special pleader for the Jews. He was a very cautious man, but he did set up the War Refugee Board, and around that time, Breckinridge Long was forced out. He wasn't so much an obstacle to the War Refugee Board as he was earlier to Jewish immigration. I'll come this way. No? Okay. All right, how much time do we have? two big questions, particularly the first one about what were the American Jewish leaders doing, particularly those who had access to Roosevelt. Were they pushing hard enough, or were they more concerned about their own positions? And then a second question about the Jewish-owned New York Times. First, about the Jewish leaders. Again, I go back to my Jewish proverb, where there were two Jews, there were three opinions. The Jewish leadership was deeply divided. During the persecution phase, before we get to the Holocaust, there were two big divisions in the Jewish leadership. One was the American Jewish Congress, led by the most famous Jewish spokesperson of the time. And you know who that was? Rabbi Stephen S. Wise. At the other pole was the American Jewish Congress, led by a less famous guy by the name of Cyrus Adler. Wise and the Congress were very militant. They organized rallies. They organized demonstrations. They tried to put pressure on the administration. At every point, they were opposed by the American Jewish Committee. Why? Because the American Jewish Committee believed that such rallies would backfire and would jeopardize the status of the Jews in Germany. Wise would respond, how could it be worse for the Jews in Germany? You know, we can't sit still. It is a myth, however, that the Jewish leadership had much access to FDR. FDR did not meet with any Jewish leaders until 1936, and then later only occasionally met with Jewish leaders. Certainly, things would have been better if Jews had been unified behind a single position, but the truth is, FDR was not especially susceptible to Jewish pressure for the simple reason that he had the Jewish vote. Jews were voting 85 to 90% for him. They were not going to vote for the isolationist, restrictionist, somewhat anti-Semitic Republican Party. So even if the Jews had been more united, it's by no means clear that it would have made any difference in FDR's policies. Later during the Holocaust, you got new divisions between Rabbi Wise, who continues to be a major leader, the committee kind of fades as an important influence, and this group of Palestinians that I talked about. They were known as the Bergson Group, after Peter Bergson, who was a transplanted member of the Irgun, the right-wing organization in Palestine. And they argued that Wise and his group was not militant enough, even though Wise was pretty militant, that even more pressure had to be put on FDR. And again, in some ways, the divisions between the Bergson group and the Wise group were beneficial, because Wise could operate from the inside. It was Rabbi Wise, not the State Department, that released the Riegner telegram informing the world of the Holocaust in November 1942. It was Wise, when he met with Roosevelt, who pushed somewhat successfully against the State Department for a pro-Palestinian and pro-rescue policy. So you kind of had the inside and the outside. I don't think, you know, during the Holocaust, a single Jewish policy and approach would have made a difference. The New York Times has something of a bad rap. In fact, prior to the Riegner telegram, the New York Times extensively covered the reports of the killing of Jews in Europe. Far more, about half the stories from all the papers came from the New York Times, a number of them on the front page. The reason the New York Times has been so criticized, and rightly so, is when Wise introduces the Regner telegram, the first confirmation that this is, you know, a wholesale attempt at mass slaughter of Jews, not just random atrocities, the Times does not put it on their front page. But neither does any other major newspaper in the United States. Why not? It's Rabbi Wise. It's a private citizen. It's a Jew with an axe to grind. Later, in December, when you get an Allied declaration with regard to Nazi atrocities, it does get on the front page in the New York Times. So it's a mixed record for the Times. Other questions? Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Yes. Great question. What was the role of Eleanor Roosevelt? Now, Eleanor, unlike Franklin, actually grew up in an anti-Semitic household. And in her early life was pretty anti-Semitic. There are lots of statements from her denouncing Jews. But she changes, particularly when she becomes friends with the wife of Eleanor Morgenthau, the wife of Henry Jr. She becomes friendly with Bernard Brooke, but she is not a big advocate of rescue and aid efforts for the Jews, not nearly as much as she is for minorities and women in the US. She writes a column. Anybody know what that column was? My Day. She writes it every day from 1935 on. The first time she directly addresses the plight of the Jews is 1943, 8 years into it. And ultimately she says, I greatly sympathize with these poor peoples, but I don't know what we can do about them. So her advocacy on this issue is not very strong. Where she is strong is she's an honorary chairman of a rescue group that brings in prominent Jewish intellectuals and artists, kind of one by one. But in terms of an advocate for the big problem, no. Yes, ma'am. Very important. And Abba Hill Silva represents kind of the next generation of Jewish leadership. He's much younger than Rabbi Wise or Cyrus Adler or Louis Brandeis, or the first generation of Jewish leadership that grew up in the Zionist movement of the war. And he is very, very militant. Even more, he's in the same group as Wise, but he and Wise are big rivals. And what Abba Hill Silva's singular accomplishment was, he persuades the Republican Party in 1944, when Tom Dewey is running, to come out with a pro-Palestinian, pro-Jewish state platform, which in turn influences the Democrats to come out and match and even top them. So he's a very, very important figure at this time. Not nearly as well known as some of the others, but should not be neglected. You're absolutely right. Correct. Let me take that one first. Hold the second one. Jan Karski, a leader of the Polish underground, does meet with Roosevelt, but he meets with Roosevelt several months after the Regner telegram. So Roosevelt already knows what's going on. What's coming from Karski is not news to him. And basically what he tells Karski, which made Karski unhappy because he wanted more specific initiatives, was, tell your people we will win the war as soon as possible. This is early 1943. How many troops did the US have, leaving aside Italy, on the continent, anywhere near the death camps in 1943, throughout 1943, through mid-1944? How many troops do we have? Zero. We didn't have any troops until D-Day in June of 1944, and we didn't secure our positions until December of 44. So the truth is, you know, as horrific as it was, the options to do something dramatic about the Holocaust at that time were very limited. You had another question?
My second point was, Jews who had the ear of Roosevelt and Bernard Brooke influenced him by saying, you don't want to take any of these Jews because they're the wrong time to
Imagine that, political leader protecting his own interests. The truth is, you're right about Baruch. Roosevelt despised Bernard Baruch. He thought he was a self-important, pompous windbag, and Bernard Baruch had absolutely no influence whatsoever upon anything that Roosevelt did or didn't do. He was never within, unlike others, like Felix Frankfurter, Henry Morgenthau Jr., and maybe the most important guy, Samuel Rosenman, who had worked with Roosevelt in his campaign of 1928 and stayed with him to the end. Baruch was never in that inner circle. One more? Better be a blockbuster.
My parents were from Vienna, and they always used to tell me, I think you alluded to it, if you could clarify about, did Roosevelt institute that part that no immigrant should be a burden on the...
That was Hoover. And Roosevelt ends it in 36. That was Hoover in 30. Can we take one more? If anyone has a burning question, I'll take one more. Way in the back there. Go ahead. Ask not for whom the bell tolls. Fortunately, no. I don't think there's certainly a lot of anti-Semitism around the world, a lot of anti-Semitism, as you know, in the Middle East, and if something horrific were to happen, it would probably happen in the Middle East, which is why I think it is so absolutely critical that however we do it, we don't allow Iran to develop nuclear weapons. So that's the one part of the world where I do see at least some potential for tragedy, but certainly within the United States. The anti-Semitism that was so rife during the 1930s is vastly diminished. Prior to the war, when the Gallup took a poll and they asked, would you vote for a completely qualified Jew for president of the United States? 50% of Americans said no, just because they were Jewish. Shortly after the war, that drops to about 8% and is even lower today. So I don't see it's so hard to, draw historical parallels between very, very different times. But I have to say, we really don't know, most of our policymakers, what the lessons of the Holocaust really are, as I illustrated with Obama. Is the lesson that we should jump in with military force when there are humanitarian crises abroad? Or is the lesson that only makes things worse? Look at Libya today. Some could argue it's worse than it was. So this remains, an incredibly vexing, incredibly difficult dilemma. And I think if there is any parallel, current and future American presidents are going to be wrestling with a lot of the same issues and a lot of the same dilemmas and a lot of the same kind of political opposition that FDR wrestled with in the 1930s. Thank you all so much. Thank you.